day the Lord has made.
Let it be holy.
Open up to page 922, not 92. The fifth chapter of the Gospel of our Lord is proclaimed by the holy evangelist St. John. Sixth verse reads, when Jesus saw him and knew that he had been lying there a long time, he said to him, do you want to be healed? هَذَا رَأَهُ يَسُوْ مُتَجِعًا وَأَلِّمَا إِنَّهُ لَهُ زَمَانٍ كَسِيرًا فَقَالَ لَهُ أَتُرِيدُ أَنْ تَبْرَأَ. Christ has risen the dead, trampling down death by death upon those who are bestowing life. This past week, I received a phone call from a family, from a young man, that his mother was very ill, and they had her on life supports. He wanted to know if I would please come and pray for her. And these are people that do not come to church. In fact, to quote one of the members of their family, they said they only seem to remember you when somebody dies to be baptized or married. And the last time I saw this family was at a funeral. But the young man on the phone told me they had found Christ, and I thought, well, I can't do much for the mother, but maybe we could do something for the son. So we went to the hospital, and we prayed, and I said, I want you to know how I pray in these situations. This is where somebody's on a respirator, on life support. I always pray the same way. I say, please God, if it is your will to take this person, do it quickly and painlessly and welcome them into your heavenly kingdom. If it is not, then I ask that you make them well again so they may continue their walk with you. But how do you pray that prayer if the person hasn't been walking with the Lord? This question of our Lord might seem almost rhetorical. Do you want to be healed? I know somebody that's trying to sell a house near me, young man from Lebanon. He bought the house as an investment, and the house has been for sale for over 2 years. The reason I saw him mowing the lawn, I said, you're having a hard time selling the house. He said, yeah, I can't find the buyer. I said, I could find the buyer for you within 2 hours. He said, really? I said, yeah. I said, do you have it listed someplace? Because I have it on Craigslist. I said, okay. Leave that there. Let's change the price to $1,000. He said, $1,000? I said, you could sell it like that for $1,000. I asked him, how much are you asking? He told me. I said, that's exactly it. You're asking for it, but you're not going to get it. So if you want to sell it, how much do you want to sell it? So if you want something, there's a price to be paid. So when we ask, or we say, Lord, please heal me, what are we willing to pay? We had a family 30-something years ago. The man was a three-pack-a-day cigarette smoker. If not three, 2.5. That's a lot of cigarettes. What's that, what is it, 20 a pack? So that's 50, can you imagine smoking 50 cigarettes a day? 50 cigarettes a day. He developed lung cancer. We talked to him, he said, I love it. I said, okay, good, you love it. So when you die, we'll put a pack of cigarettes in the coffin with you. He said, no, don't do that. Put a carton. I said, okay, we'll put a carton in the coffin with you. So how much does he want to be healed? Not enough to give up the cigarettes. So how much do we want to be healed? How much are we willing to pay? Because we're not willing to pay that much. We want it all, but we don't want to pay the price. And Jesus wants to heal us. He wants to make us well, but we're not willing to pay the price. We're not willing to give that devotion. I said before the Holy Communion was issued this morning about people who come to church and they disappear. We have ghosts in this church. They're here at the beginning, and then they're gone. imagine putting on a very, very fancy dinner and someone comes in and you've got maybe four or five courses and they come in at the beginning, thank you for inviting me, and they skip each course till you get to the main course. They're there for the main course and then they leave before the dessert. You say, well, that's their loss. But it's also disrespectful. We live in a society, and I have talked about this, and I will talk about it again. We live in a society where we do not know respect. I learned years ago, probably about 3 years ago, because you know that I save all year to take a vacation to go to France. I love France, I love Paris. And yes, just the other night, on Friday night, I was talking to the husband of my cousin from Palm Bay. He said, I hated France. I couldn't wait to get out of it. I said, why? He said, they're so rude. They're so rude. I said, let me ask you a question. When you spoke to them, did you tell them, bonjour? He said, I don't speak French. I said, this is just one word. You can't learn one word. I guarantee you, in the Middle East, not France, in the Middle East, when you see someone, you tell them marhaba, right? And the second thing is, either kifak, unless you're from Damascus, then you say shlonak. You see, but the point is that you greet people. So my point is, we have no respect in our society. So we come to Jesus and say, oh Jesus, oh Jesus, oh Jesus, I need this, I need that. But the rest of the time, we don't know Jesus. We don't care about Jesus. We don't care about the church. So people who come to church, get there on time, get absolution, and then they disappear. We don't know where they are, and then they come to communion. My God, if we're telling people who came after the reading of the scripture, you cannot receive communion because you didn't hear the scripture lesson, how can we give somebody communion who came at the beginning and was gone the whole time, and then reappears? Oh, Father John, you're so tough. You're so, where's Marina? Marina. Yeah, later on, I'm going to refer all the people that tell me I'm tough and refer them to you. We talk about the priests are in Russia. Okay? Tell them about the priests are in Greece. Okay? You talk about tough? I remember a friend of mine who came from Lebanon right during the war. It's a true story. He is Orthodox and his wife was not Orthodox and they got married in Beirut during the war, 1978, I think. You believe this? The Orthodox priest, he had his robe, called it in Arabic jibbi, or in Greek rasa. You know what he had under the jibbi? He had a belt with two holsters and guns. Yeah, he had handguns. He did. I said, he had guns? He said, yeah. Because somebody attacked the church so he could defend the people as they got away. We are tough. So when we tell people, if you really mean the communion, if you really want the communion, you have to make a little bit of sacrifice. What kind of come to church and then you go disappear? When I first came to Orlando, I think Monique remembers this, we were using a Methodist church chapel in Winter Park. Okay, it was a straight shot, much narrower building than this, and you could see from the altar to the front doors. And one of the altar boys, I looked out from the altar front door, I saw his father and another fellow smoking a cigarette outside during the liturgy. I said to the boy, please tell you, go to your father and invite him to come back into the church. He came back, his father didn't come in. He said, he's not ready. He's still smoking. As you go back and tell your father, he doesn't put the cigarette on now and come now, I'm going to stop the liturgy and I'm going to go tell him to either go home or come inside. Oh, Father John, you're so tough. Because I am consumed. I am consumed with that zeal for Jesus. And I know many people are not, and I understand that. But please don't expect me to lower my zeal for Jesus and the church because people don't want to do what's right. I didn't make the rule. It's common sense. Can you imagine going to a court and you're a witness and they call you And you'd say, I'm not ready yet. Tell the judge, I'll be in 5 minutes. I got to finish this call. You know what they call that? Contempt of court. So why I tell you this, because if you want to be healed and you're not well, ask yourself why. If you cough a lot, stop smoking. If you can't breathe because of your weight, stop eating so much. If your mind is always befuddled, stop drinking all the time. If you don't think God is listening to your prayers, then listen to God. Maybe that's the way we should do it, because we should listen first to God. Because Lord says, the sick man answered him, Sir, I have no man to put me into the pool when the water is troubled. And while I am going down, another steps down before me. Ajabu al-maridu yasayidu. Laysa li insanin yulkini fi al-birkati ma tataharraka al-ma'u. Bal baynama ana atin yanzilu qudami arfaru. You see, a real Christian would have helped that man. That's why I have the story, okay, about the man that was robbed on the way to Jericho, the Good Samaritan. A real Christian helps. A real Christian says, go in front of me. Go ahead. A real Christian does not grab what they can grab and the heck with anybody else. Not a real Christian. This man wouldn't have been sitting there for 38 years if someone had not been so darn selfish. My God, the man's sitting there, he can't get down to the pool of water in time. Can nobody help this man? There's no, because nobody cares. People don't care about anyone but themselves. And we live in this society. Me, 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 me. What I want, what I need, what's coming to me. Not the other guy. Thank God that the way America is like that, for this homeless would starve to death. So a real Christian would have helped this man. And finally, it says in verse 14, Jesus went into the temple and said to him, See, you are well. Sin no more, let nothing worse befall you. بعد ذلك وجده يسوع في الهيكل وقال له ها أنت قد بردت قال تختت أيضا لئلا يكون لك أشار. There is no healing if we're going to continue to have the same situation, the same sinning. And what's worse is that once we're healed, and this is true, check it out. Most people, I'm just a very example, for example, most people, when they go on a diet and they lose 20, 30, 40 pounds, guess what happens? They gain it all back. You know why? Because they didn't make a fundamental change. Just the other day, someone told me, they said, my God, how do you stay so thin? I said, I was a fat kid. It's almost impossible to not be a fat kid if you're raised, I can speak only on this because I know about it. If you're raised in a Middle Eastern house, Ferris, what do they always tell you? Look good, look eat, look eat, look eat. My mother told me to eat more and she told me she loved me. Eat, eat, eat. Mediterranean people, Greeks, Italians, all Mediterranean people, they don't make four pork chops for four people. No. We make the whole pig. Okay? We make the whole pig. And when you eat till you can't eat anymore, what they tell you, oh, come on, eat some more. Because we show love by eating. So when you know how I lost weight? True story. I was 18 years old. It's a long time ago. And I could never lose weight. My mother knew that I'm the type you put in front of me, I'm gonna eat it. And she did that. So finally my parents went on a 2-week vacation and they didn't take me, thank God. I said, this is your chance. So I went to the health food store. I never forgot this. These were Swedish crackers. Air has more taste than those Swedish crackers had. Air has more taste. I ate those things till they were coming out of my ear. I kept eating. Everybody was okay, another Swedish cracker, another Swedish cracker, another Swedish cracker. You know what happened? I lost 7 pounds. My mother, God bless her, she came and she was, oh! Oh my God! What happened to you? Oh! I said, stay away from me. Don't bring me any more food. Please, I lost 7 pounds. And she did everything possible. She made all my favorite foods. Not gonna eat it, not gonna eat it. I wound up going from, truthfully, 164 pounds to 119 pounds. Okay? I lost further, 45 pounds. I was so thin, and I'm sorry because I don't mean to make fun of the Holocaust, but had you tattooed numbers on my arm, that's, I have a picture of it, I looked like that. And my mother was convinced that I was going to die, but from that point on, I gained some pounds back because I needed to. But to this day, and how many of that, 41 years ago, I never lost sight of that because I made a commitment. I'm not going to ever be fat like that again because I didn't like me. So if you want to change something in your life, you have to stick with it. We are a throwaway society. Just who is it? Oh, Chris Wilson, who's on his way to Bulgaria. He said, Brother John, I'm going to give up smoking when I go to Bulgaria. I said, you want to give up smoking? Give up smoking now. Not when you go to Bulgaria. Well, it'll be easy. You see, that's the problem. You're going to stop doing something. Stop it now. Don't wait for some magic day. Stop it now. If you're going to turn to Jesus, do it now. If you're going to make a commitment to the Lord, if you're going to make a promise, and I know that a lot of you do not understand me. I cannot help it. I'm nuts about Jesus. Biggest thing in my life, my whole life. So yeah, if I tell you, come to church, and there are people that have known me for the 43 years I've been in Orlando, and they will tell you, Father John is consistent about one thing, is he tells the same thing over and over again, come to church, go to church, come to the liturgy. Every time. Why? Because this is where it's at. Those people that either come late, way late, or people who come and then go, no, we're sorry. It's not us. They have to make a change. We have to be either serious or not serious about Jesus, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Let us pray to the Lord.
We will have the Coptic Orthodox priest with us, the Malabar or Indian Orthodox priest with us. We'll have the Serbian Orthodox priest with us, as well as Father James and Stevens. And we're going to just learn the differences between the Coptic God and the Greek Orthodox Church. So that will be this coming Wednesday at 6 o'clock. The following Wednesday, we'll talk about this again next Sunday. We have a nun coming from Belarus. She's here to talk about monasticism in Russia today. Her name, I believe, Sister Linda. So that will also be at 6 o'clock on that Wednesday. And the following Wednesday, we have our last seminar of the year. It's entitled Intro Catholic. And we will have with us the Maronite Catholic priest, the Byzantine Catholic priest, as well as the member of the Greek Orthodox Church. And we'll be discussing more of the differences between the Roman Catholic and the Orthodox churches. If you took a full copy of your box, some of you did, I need you please return them quickly. We send the total of the donations to this program, so please, it's very important because we have someone that has volunteered to match whatever funds we collect in full copy of your box, so please return those as soon as possible. And finally, this coming Friday, a season of more. Inviting us to his home for dinner at 6:37. Just a kind of a get together, get to enjoy each other's company fellowship and the Bible study. So that will be coming this coming Friday.